Welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service.
The Holy Ghost. If you believe that, give him one more shout of praise in the house this morning.
I need
like bursting with a heavenly language. Every time I get a taste, you know what? I just want more. I just want more.
Yeah.
trumpets will ring. Sing it like you mean it today. Our greatest days are still ahead. Oh, he's just getting started. And our lips will raise the loudest praise. Oh, we're just getting started. Thank you, Lord. There is one day. Best days are in front of us, Jesus. Do you believe that this morning? I know we've got all kinds of situations in this room, so many circumstances of life that we've been through and going through, but I thank God that every new day is a new moment of mercy, a new moment of grace, and a new opportunity to see him move on our behalf. Sing it again. Come on. Say, our greatest days, you say, are still up. Oh, he's just the best is in front of you. Our lips will raise the loudest. One more time. Oh, he's just getting, we're just getting started, Lord. Our greatest days are still ahead of us, oh God. Oh, he's just praise, give him praise, give him praise. Nothing too hard for you, God. You're awesome, God. We love you.
I'm believing. of the faith in the room, what the Lord can do, hey, what the Lord can do.
Come on.
It's gonna happen. Just let the way make it through, cause he's gonna move.
Do you believe it?
He's gonna move.
Yeah.
Can you imagine with all of the faith in the room, what the Lord can do?
Come on, let's disturb your spirit.
Lord.
You know, I just come from a week in Cuba, and I got to tell you, we have so many of the comforts of where we are that we come to church sometimes fragmented and disengaged. Our praise today was weak. The music was great. Our praise was weak. Our worship, music was great. I feel like your soul is thinking about something else and your body is feeling tired or whatever it's feeling, or hungry or whatever. And your spirit is drifting. I want you to close your eyes for a moment in the room and at home. I want you to close your eyes and just lift up your hands as an openness. Holy Spirit, what faith can do in the room is only limited by those of us that carry the spirit of faith, because you're willing and you want to move in this place. And yet, as we're disengaged, Lord, you said unity is important, not just unity together with brothers and sisters in the Lord, but unity of ourselves. That we would be aligned, spirit, soul, and body, in the pursuit of God, in this pursuit of God, to engage you. Lord, your word says in John chapter 4 that the woman at the well talked about, do we worship on this mountain or that mountain? And you, Jesus, you said in your word that we engage our spirit in the pursuit of the peace of God. Today we set aside all of the comforts and all of the accessibilities and all the enjoyments of routine. And we come to engage you. Living God, come into this room and settle down among our praise. Fill us in the midst of this worship with more of you. More of you. Minds be renewed and line up with what God wants to do, with the promises and purposes of the Lord. Everybody welcome the Holy Spirit. Just say, come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. One more time. Come, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name.
This is a house of worship. It's engaged. This is a place of praise. And where every demon trembles. Where we proclaim your name. Hey. This is a house of our hearts are full of faith. You have our full attention. You have the final say.
Speak to your heart. You sing it real strong. Come alive. Sing.
Come alive. In the name of Jesus. Come alive. In the name of Jesus.
There's resurrection power. Your blood runs through our veins. Your kingdom triumphs over even the coldest grave.
So we say,
come alive in the name of Jesus. Jesus, come alive in the name of Jesus. feet of Jesus, everything in the name of Jesus. This is
hey, church,
a house
this is your chance.
Of miracles.
You sing it. Come alive, you say, come alive.
In the name of Jesus, come alive.
That's it.
In the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles.
It's where you stand today, so we pray every day.
It's in the feet of Jesus, everything. In the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles.
Come on, yeah. Yes, yes, yes. Now that feels better, huh? That kind of ties in my thought here because you know what? I appreciate that encouragement, Pastor. I appreciate that because sometimes you come in and we're just scattered so much on our brain and we get like, we could get all the way through worship and not be challenged to really engage. And then you're not ready for the word. Because you're not prepared. So this whole month is Pastor's Appreciation Month. And here's the thing we ask for you. The main thing we ask from you, prayer. Will you pray for us? Pray for your pastors in this church that we would remain sharp, that we would remain inspired, that we would be right out on the edge of what God is doing in the moment. So we'd have these moments where we're able to come in and we're refreshed and we're alive and we're sharp and we're seeing what God is doing and we bring that to you and we're able to help you be equipped and encouraged for the call of God on your life as well too. So we ask you for your prayer. Why? Listen, you're investing in yourself when you're praying for us. You are. And that's the best thing you can do for us. And so we have these we're going to be passing out to you at the end of service. And we'll remind you again. But these are some things that we put together. Miss June has put this together for us. And it's some great scriptures that are daily scriptures you can pray over us. And man, I tell you what, when I know somebody says they're praying for me, that's better than anything, right? Just to know that we have that covering, you know? So I don't know, I could just say more, but I'm just gonna stop right there. So please be remembering during this time. Thank you for when you come up and you love on us, and thank you, we really appreciate you. Thank you for that. But when you say you're praying for us, okay, I'll leave that alone. That's enough, okay? And we have another thing that we're gonna be believing God for this morning too. We've got our DC trip. Plan that we've been putting together for a while. It's our prayer missions trip in D.C. We've got 11 people that are ready and raring to go, and they're going to be launching out on Wednesday, going up there on Wednesday, and they go up there, and if you don't know what our D.C. trips are all about, they put together some specific prayer assignments. They go with a strategy, and they pray over our nation. So we want to pray for our team, but we also want to pray and agree, come into agreement for them as they pray over our capital, over our nation, and believe God for his purpose and his plan to come to pass, right? So let's pray right now and pray for our team. Right now, just wave. If you're one of our 11 people and you're in the service right now, wave and look around. You see them there? You see them? If you're right around them, just stretch your hands and we'll be praying for them right now. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your wisdom and your guidance and the leadership of the Spirit of God on our team as they go. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you're going to empower them and empower their intercession and their prayer. Father, thank you that they're going to be able to agree and see your purposes and your promises manifest from heaven right down to earth, pulling it down into our nation, into our capital, Lord, into our leaders there. Father, we pray for great wisdom and strategies for them. And we pray for your grace and your ability, Lord, your peace all the way through. Lord, we pray that you would send angels before them to push resistance out of the way and that they would find great favor everywhere they go. And Lord, we believe you for our nation and our capital, Lord, our leadership there. We believe you, Lord, for a nation that honors you, for leadership that honors you, Lord, for plans and policies, Lord, that honor you, Jesus. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for your purpose coming forth in our nation in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So good. And come up here for a second. I need your help because today is a special day as well, too, isn't it? Because it's Pastor Lindsay's birthday, right? Yes. So what I need your help with is I need to hear like a happy birthday tune.
In three-part harmony.
Three-part harmony.
I'm going to put it in
three-part harmony. Wait, wait, wait. So find the high note for me. Happy birthday. Don't let him do all the work. It's his birthday. Find a note for me.
I'm an F.
That's low for me, but okay.
And then find a lower one for the guys. Find something high for sopranos.
This has not been this hard.
Go ahead.
Okay, ready? And it's Pastor Lindsay. It'd be easy to say P L. 2 p.m. Okay. We got it all coordinated?
Ready?
Right. Ready? Go.
Happy birthday to you.
Me.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear P.L. Happy birthday to you.
We love you. We love you. Man, I just love that guy so much. You're amazing. Okay, so now what do? I've been on vacation, I forget. Okay, everyone, turn around and welcome everybody around you. Just give them a high five, and then we'll continue on in a minute. Good to see everybody. We've got some good stuff happening. I want to jump right into the in the know because we've got some good pictures to share with you. And we've got some youth things that happened this last week. We had games. Let's see. Guys and Games with Now Youth. Guys and Games. And they had some good stuff. Go ahead and pop up some stuff there. They went to Easy Street and had a good time there. And of course, you know, there's certain benefits of being youth pastor and our student pastor because he has all the fun playing the games and all that stuff. So our guys out there having a good time taking over. So listen, everyone that is involved, if you got a youth that is looking for something to do, Now Youth is amazing. I'm telling you, it's amazing. They've got all kinds of stuff happening for the guys, for the ladies, and just having a good time. So let's give it up one more time for our Now Youth. They're cool, amazing. Good group of guys. And then we also had something amazing happen this last week. We had all the ladies gathering together for Happy Fall, y'all. And so they gathered together and had a good time. Yeah, look at that. It's just incredible how they do things up. I mean, incredible, right? And so we heard so many great testimonies. We had some of the people that got up, some of the ladies that got up and really shared from their hearts some things that were happening in their life that God was doing in them. And Pastor Gail was saying that there are so many newer ladies coming. We're just getting to know and starting to develop relationships and everything. So that's incredible, seeing God doing some fresh things in Now Church and new people coming in, the fresh new experiences. So it's really cool. So again, let's give it up for our Now Church ladies. They know how to have a great time together. And when these events come up, you don't want to miss them, all right? So it's really good. And now, if you are newer to Now Church, we always want to make sure that we're connecting with you and getting to know you. And so the first place that you can get to know a little bit and get some of the information even about the church is at our guest experience counter there. And that's right in the Legacy Building. As you go out, you'll see that counter. We have some nice people ready to just give you some gifts and welcome you for coming. And also, I was just talking to a few people this morning that were in their three-week challenge. A gentleman just finished 3 weeks right here. And I talked to another young gentleman. He was here last Sunday, and he was here for first service that I heard you had no power. I was on vacation. What did I miss? And I heard it was a powerful, incredible time. First service, Pastor Gail. And then second service, she came in and she preached in here. So I told this gentleman, I said, actually, you should get the credit for two of your three-week challenges. And that one Sunday, because that was quite amazing. What is three-week challenges? Check out now, church, 3 weeks in a row and see what God does. That's faith. Because we believe that as you're making room for God in your life, like Pastor Richard was saying, you're focusing your mind, your will, your emotions, your spirit. You're aligning yourself to hear from God, and he has some things to say to you, all right? All right, are you ready for the word? All right, let's welcome up our pastor as he comes up with a fresh new series.
Much. Thank you, Pastor Chris. Welcome back. Glad that you're with us. It is exciting to be home. I nearly kissed the ground when I got into Miami and then into Orlando, and there is no place like home, but there's no better feeling than being sent by God to accomplish something. And so I'm going to kind of weave in the beginning of what this month stands for us, what the series is going to be about, and then I want to tell you and show you some pictures. The last thing that we're not going to make you feel guilty today for being blessed. A lot of times people come back from third world country missions trips, and it's all about, hey, let's all go on a guilt trip. And that's not what we're about, but I'll sure tell you, we better appreciate what we have. That's the main thing. We better be thankful for what we have. If you ever wanted to be angry at an ideology, go with me to Cuba sometime. We'll talk more about that. It's like the government there pressed pause in 1959. And now they're celebrating the Revolucion 65th anniversary next year. And everybody behind the scenes is just going, oh, they've destroyed our nation. But they can't say it publicly, because there's no freedom of speech. Anyway, I've been moved. I've been affected. I've been impacted. I've been empowered, and I want to bring that to you as best I can. We're going to begin a series this month called Ghosted, Holy Style, okay? Holy Ghosted, not ghosted in the sense of the world ghosted. We're going to talk about Holy Ghosted. Anyway, open your Bibles up, if you will, to Ephesians chapter 3, and I want to just add my congratulations to the team last week. What resilience for... So Pastor Gail is always strong in the spirit, but before she preaches on a Sunday morning, sometimes she's a little bit anxious. She said a little. Anyway, and so... For when I heard that the power went out, I didn't hear till hours later. I didn't hear till last Sunday night that the power went out, and 5 minutes before the service, and many of you were already in here, and that she was calm, and the leadership anointing on her life. She just said to our team, "Let's grab a chair and go over to the Legacy Building." Yeah, give it up for Pastor Gail. I mean, that's grace under fire right there. That's the power of God right there. I'm just really proud of her and the team, and the word went forth. And I think it was I felt it was you were empathizing with where I was, because there was no air conditioning down there in the church or anywhere but the hotel. Anyway, also, Pastor Lindsay, happy birthday. I can't believe you're 40 already, so it's amazing. He's been with us 30 years leading worship since he was 10 years old. Anyway, some people will just believe that. But anyway, I think he looks about 38. What do you think? 38 years old? Not bad at all. You fine wine. Ephesians 3, verse 14 is our text for the month. It is, ironically, the passage just before what I preached 2 weeks ago, "Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above." And this is really important. It really is a thread from heaven. "For this reason," Paul writes, "I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory, his presence, to be strengthened, listen, with might through his spirit in the inner man, the real you, the hidden man of the heart, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. Love, the God kind of love, the love of the Father is the foundation for the spirit of might. It's not separate. I'll tell you that why that's important in a minute. That Christ may dwell in your hearts of faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love and may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. And then at the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, he gives the great commission and closes with Matthew 28:20, for I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And the confirming New Testament, Hebrews 13:5b, says, for Jesus, for God himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. His love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me or you. Let's pray one more time. Father God, would you open the eyes of our heart to your great love? Teach us about your agape and help us to live in the midst of it, in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, in the Spirit-empowered Church of Jesus, we often use the word anointed or the anointing. I'll never forget when my wife and I filled the Holy Spirit, 1986, we were nice, mild-mannered Presbyterians, and we got filled the Holy Spirit in the privacy of our own home, and suddenly we were kicked out of the Presbyterian Church. And I got nothing against the Presbyterians. We used to call ourselves the Frozen Chosen, and that's exactly, so, you know, it's good, it's all good. It's interesting, I just encountered on this trip a lot of people that, in fact, I met a pastor from Louisiana who had the exact same experience. He's about 10 years younger than me or more, but he had the same experience in the same denomination we were part of, and he and his wife got filled with the Holy Spirit, and suddenly they were churchless. It's very interesting, isn't it? You know, how sometimes the church limits what a limitless God can do. But I remember hearing the word anointed or the anointing. We were, within a few weeks, went to visit Pastor Benny Hinn's church in Orlando back then, where there was a move of God, and suddenly we're hearing about the anointing, and I didn't know what the anointing meant. I didn't know, and I looked it up. I looked, you know, the dictionary version of the word anointed meant like to be smeared with butter or oil. I'm thinking, well, I don't get that one. I mean, I love butter. I love oil, but don't want to be smeared with it necessarily. It's crucial that we broaden our understanding of the terminology this month. What do we mean by the anointing of the Holy Spirit? And how does it work? How do we live in that? How can we live a more supernatural life because of the anointing? I would define the anointing, a biblical definition, is simply the tangible manifestation of God here and now. It is to experience the presence of God now, in this moment. The anointing is not about the future, and the anointing is not about the past. The anointing is only now, and now, and now, and now. Now, the world's definition of the word ghosted, you know, you talk about in the age of, you know, social media, the word ghosted now suddenly means to be suddenly rejected and abandoned. As if you had no relationship, to be canceled or blocked on all devices and platforms. Ghosted. Holy ghosted is to be thoroughly and lavishly loved, to be thoroughly accepted by the Lord, no matter what. He will never, ever, 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 ever. He will never, ever reject or abandon you. He will never, ever. You know what? Pastor, you don't know what I did last night. He will never, ever, 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 ever reject or abandon you. His love is so powerful and so vast. But you don't know what somebody did to me. He will never, ever, ever, ever abandon or reject you. How many know that you've already done some crazy stuff and he loved you anyway and drew you back? Amen. So this is a love that is almost, that's why Paul said, it's my aim. I want you to understand the width and the length and the depth and the height of this agape force, love of the Father, because unless you experience it, you'll never get it with your head. I submit to you, something just flew into my mouth. And I'm just going to swallow whatever it is. It was like a little piece of fuzz just came down from the ceiling. Then I breathed it in. Thank God it didn't go in my lungs. Holy Spirit, I hope that was you. Descending like a dove. Descending like a dove. I need a Holy Ghost. Wow. Interesting. I don't think that's ever happened in 36 years of ministry and 33 years here. Okay. I think we should go over to the other building. No. In light of that love, I want to talk about this mission to Cuba. So this month we're going to develop the whole thing. By the way, next Sunday, don't miss next Sunday for anything live and in person. Pastor Julian Melfi and his wife Sharon from London, England will be here. Some of our favorite speakers here that come once in a while from London. Mighty man of God. Pastor Julian's been my dear friend for over 25 years, and he's coming next week bringing the word. So don't miss that. And then the rest of the month, I'll be in the pulpit with this word on ghosted. And we're going to develop this thought about the Father's love and the anointing and how that anointing works. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you for sending me, by the way. Thank you for praying for me. There were at least two or three times. Remember I jokingly said 2 weeks ago, if you see this face like that, please pray for me. I sent up the bat signal like three times. I'm not kidding. By the way, let me tell you how powerful your prayers are. I just found out last night, someone had told my wife something, and I looked it up online. The U.S. Embassy, which is just an existing building, we haven't had an embassy there in 7 years. Again, and previously since 1959, there was a diabolical plan from bad actors that did some stuff to our diplomats and people that were in the embassy about 7 years ago, and a new type of sonic warfare. You can read about it online. Anyway, last Sunday, it turns out there was a terrorist attack at the U.S. Embassy in Cuba last week. I passed by there Sunday morning, and nothing was happening. I passed by there Tuesday afternoon again, and there was a lot of activity there, and I didn't know why because there's no Americans there. It turns out someone threw two Molotov cocktails into the U.S. Embassy last Sunday, and your prayers protected me and protected us on our team. That's a great, we didn't even know what happened. Because, of course, there they don't tell you anything. I could not post anything until I got back. So after you'll see these, I'm going to show you some pictures in a few minutes. I will be posting some more stuff this week. But they asked us, please don't post it till you get home. It's dangerous in some ways. The one time that I sent up the bat signal was a week ago Friday night. We went out, so we had a conference We arrived last Thursday night. Friday morning, we started in this big conference in a church that lasted all day Friday, Friday night, and Saturday. Very powerful. And Friday night, we went out from that conference and we went to these home meetings from the church that were, they call them lighthouses of love. And they, it was a word from the Lord from our leader. I'll tell you about him in a few minutes. The leader of this group is from Norway, a man of God named Leif Hetland, very powerful apostolic evangelist. And he goes, this was his 48th time in Cuba. When he started going there 23 years ago, he had to sneak in from Honduras or some other Central American country because they wouldn't let Westerners even come in. And he had to sneak in. And now he gets to fly in and enjoy a nice hotel. There were no hotels that they could stay in until just a few years ago. Even 5 years ago, his groups that would go down there had to stay in dormitories at like a Methodist church or something. Really tough conditions. So we were in decent hotels. They were nice when they were new. They're not great now. Food was rough. The food was rough, even in the hotels. It was a challenging trip. But they had this evangelist, Leif Hetland, he's a Norwegian guy who lives in Atlanta. And the team with him, the other pastors, precious pastors from Philippines who ministered with him that came, and other places. It was very powerful. There were, I don't know, maybe, we had a group of 40 of us, and there were probably 12 states represented in that group of 40 and several nations. But the word of the Lord came in a conversation with the pastors in Cuba. Leif Hetland gave his vision a year ago for these lighthouses of love. Today there are 180 lighthouses of love in 1 year. And so it's a place where the underground church, and I'll explain underground church either today or whenever I have time, because underground doesn't mean hidden. Underground just means not official. They can exist, but their freedoms are this much, and they're spied on constantly. So it's very interesting. But anyway, so we went to one of these lighthouses of love. Can you cue up the first couple of pictures? So this is a lighthouse of love. This was out in the jungle, and as we were traveling out, just keep that one up for a moment. As we were traveling out to this place about an hour away from Havana into the jungle, we were on these rocky roads on our bus. And suddenly, as we were turning down the last street to walk down to go to this place, a motorcycle guy stopped our driver and said, "Your front tire is flat." And we're like, "Oh, great." Well, we didn't know. We've been driving forever. And they said, "Well, luckily, it's only another, you know, half a mile, quarter of a mile that way." So we walked the rest of the way. This is just a small block building. And that tarp, the people around that in this little church meeting, they praised God with all their might. It was hot and humid. It was rough conditions. And we heard from the lady that started this place. She started 17 lighthouses of love. She goes to 17 different places all over east of Havana. And this is one of them. These people are out there, very powerful, very strong. And what happened was at the end, she said, because it started to rain, and the people that were outside, those of us outside the covering, got rained on. And she said, and the overseer said, "It's my dream to get double-sized the tarp." And I said, "How much is it going to be?" And I was able to sow a seed from Now Church right away to help toward that new tarp. So that's one thing right away. Bam, there you go. We're going to, okay, you need a tarp? If that's where we're at, let's do that. Now, I'm embarrassed to tell you that I said to the pastor, he was with us, the senior pastor of the church, Pastor Yasser and his wife Aki were with us. And I said to him, we got an hour drive back. Is there, you know, a baño. Is anywhere, you know, donde este el baño? That's the first phrase you learn as a missionary from America going into a Spanish-speaking country. For those of you who don't know, it means where's the bathroom? And he smiled, because I thought there was one in this block building. He said, everywhere. He said, just go choose your tree. Anyway, second picture. So this is Pastor Yasser. I say, Yasser, that's my baby right there. Yasser. Anyway, I want him to come. Great man of God, mighty man of God. He was probably one of the most famous evangelists in Cuba as revivals have begun there. And now his church is packed with people. Show you that in a few moments. But then these 180 and growing lighthouses of love, where they not only have services once a week, but then they bring each of these lighthouses of love food. And I'll show you that. We did that toward the end of our trip. We went and fed hungry people on Tuesday before I flew back Wednesday. Next picture. So that night, you can't see it, but the little boy, the little guys right there, this guy right here, at the end of the meeting, we were about to disband, and it was hot. I mean, you sweated through everything. And one of our guys on our team came up and said, I thought we were about to disband the meeting and everybody's going to go home. I'm waiting for the benediction. And they said, no. One of our guys said, hey, I just believe God wants to heal some people tonight. So, okay. The little boy was the first person that came up. He started crying. He said he's been in pain all of his life. He has some kind of condition where his legs and his body, he's in constant pain. He started crying. And you see that. Now listen to this. Can I tell you about the love of the Father defies theology. Okay? Because sometimes God does stuff that you don't believe he can do because you don't think it's in the Word in this way. Let me explain. Little boy comes up. The team, leader of our team said, okay, where's the parents? Well, there's no dad. Bring mama up. So mama comes up. She starts crying. They said, the team said, we're going to pray for you, ma'am, and we want you to lay hands on your son and pray for him. She's crying. She lays her hands on her son. They're praying for the little boy. Little boy starts going, I don't have any more pain. The pain is gone. The pain is awesome. The pain is gone. It's gone. It's all gone. And I feel great. I feel awesome. I feel great. And he starts getting excited. You can see, you know, kids can't fake it well. And this kid just starts, you could see his face. The pain is gone. Now the mother cries even harder. And she said, I don't know how that happened. I'm not a Christian yet. So she got saved right there on the spot when her little boy got healed by the power of God. Now what I mean by that, by the theology thing is, I would think before, well, let's lead her to the Lord, and then she can be used by God. She was used by God to move in anointing before she received Jesus. That's mind-blowing love. Okay? So this was a really, really powerful thing. Now, I'll show you more pictures later. You can put that off. The team was led by this evangelist, Leif Hetland. When I ran into him at the airport. We were on the same flight from Miami, and I introduced myself. And he is a powerful leader. He's been to 106 nations, so he's ahead of me. And he's only 57. He's a young man. Anyway, so earlier this year, God used him. It's been prophesied to him for years that he would have an anointing to reach Muslims. And he said, well, this is weird. I don't like Muslims. And God sent him this year, 2023. He's now friends with the president of the Kashmir region between Pakistan and India. God has used him to reach Muslims there. And he was invited to Pakistan by the Muslim prime minister and the Muslim president. He now considers them friends. They presented him Mission of Peace Award, welcomed him to preach to Muslims, and after 3 days of preaching to Muslims, 85,000 Muslims received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in February this year. To God be the glory. When I tell you stuff's happening around the world you don't know, I tell you it's happening. Things are going on. So this is a great man of God. Really enjoyed him. His message, I think this is his message all the time, but his message that was foundational to this conference in this time of Cuba, the love of God is the foundation of all that is good. That everything emanates from the love of God. The supernatural power of God that we call the anointing flows naturally out of lives that have been saturated with the love of God. You can only have what flows to you flow through you. So if you receive God's love in a real way, you can transmit God's love without getting all hyped up or yelling and screaming about it. You can move in the power of God. I've heard a lot of people preach and teach on the love of God over the years, and I'll be honest with you. Most make the agape love of God sound so wimpy and over the top, sweet and sappy. We used to call it greasy grace and sloppy agape. I've heard people just kind of make it where you're either a warfare guy or you're a love guy. And that's when God gave me this Ephesians 3, that the strength of the Spirit in your inner man and the Spirit of might and power is totally based on the foundation of the love of the Father. God's love as Abba, Papa, to you individually, to your family, to your children, and your children's children. This was full of power, this message. They said kingdom culture comes with family language. The words love, acceptance, adoption, the Father's heart, seeking other believers as brothers and sisters in Christ. To be Holy Ghosted is to be healed from trauma. This hit me strong. That's not what they said, but that's what God said to me through this, being at this conference and being part of it. It was really exciting in a way to kind of be incognito. The last day, the coordinator, the administrator of the trip said, "So, I just heard you're a pastor." I said, "Yes, I am." She said, "Oh, that's so great. I wish I'd have known the whole trip." And I'm thinking, I'm glad you didn't. I got to be part of somebody's team. By the way, whatever our preferences are on things, I was early to every meeting. I was right there with the team on the bus before anybody else got there. I was at breakfast when they said be at breakfast. Because part of going on mission trips is being a good team member. Hint, hint. Anyway, so I just want to let you know, it was very humbling, but I loved it. I received a lot of ministry because they didn't know who I was. The great thing about mighty men and women of God that prayed for me, they discerned who I was without me saying anything. They didn't know who I was, but they started prophesying. So let me just tell you about last Sunday. When you're going through this, I was going through a hard day. It was a hard day physically. So the church service, let's start with pictures and I'll kind of maybe show and go as we are. So this is just one of our lunches, some of our team from around the country. That's Rick from Houston. So this is Alyssa from Pennsylvania. We got to present the whole Heart Smile Foundation bag of stuff that we were able to take some supplies and some things that they asked for. So Heart Smile supporters, you were part of Cuba. That bag and those goodies are down there. Good things, supplies and different things. This is Leif Hetland right there with the interpreter and a very, very powerful man of God. Let's go on. So they is the So this is inside the church service last Sunday morning. That song says, "Fill me up till I overflow, I want to run over." And they sang it for 45 minutes. People going for it. People praising God. Now, let me just tell you why that's important. Let's hold it right there. Keep it on this. So when I took that video, they put me up against I was one of the first ones in, so they put me up against the wall. There was no air moving. It was so hot, my shirt and undershirt were soaked within about 10, 15 minutes, and there was water. You'd have thought a faucet out of my elbows. Like water dripping. I probably sweated 10 pounds away last week. Unfortunately, I found it Monday. But anyway. And they had told us, don't bring your backpacks. I just had a little drawstring bag. Leave your backpacks upstairs in safety. Well, I'm sitting there. I forgot my towel. I brought one of those cooling towels. And this precious girl from North Carolina in Brittany, she looked back, precious lady. I shouldn't say girl. She just, young mom and wife to Joseph. They were there on the team. And she turns to me and she goes, are you okay? I said, I forgot my towel. She goes, I have an extra one. Same exact kind of cooling towel that I have. You'll see me in pictures wearing this thing around my neck. It's a cooling towel. Anyway, so she gives me this towel, and I'm trying to drink water, and all of a sudden my head starts to spin. I'm like, okay, I'm either dehydrating or I'm not getting enough oxygen because there's no air moving. They had fans in there, but no air conditioning, and the fans got to the first row. I was on the second row. And I go, I felt like, okay, God, what do I do now? So I had to excuse myself and go out and stand. This is my vantage point for the service. I stood outside under a tree in the shade and tried to regain my composure. The service lasted 3.5 hours. Now listen, it had to be at least 115 degrees inside the building. Let me give you, I got this analogy on the way back. Let's say we announce we're all coming, first service is all coming to your house to worship God together in your garage in August. And we're going to be in there praising Jesus for 3.5 hours. That was a taste of what I had last Sunday. And it didn't stop these people, old people, young people, children. They were going for it. They were praising God. That song, fill me up till I overflow. I want to run over. And the glory of God hit the place. And there were healings and miracles and demonstrations of the power of God. And I thought to myself, shame on us for freaking out if we go over 1 hour and 15 or 1 hour and 30 minutes in air conditioning and nice chairs. The smart people, by the way, were all standing at the door. Keep going. So this is from the pastor's. So the pastor's house is over the church, and they have a bathroom they let the church use in the back of the upstairs. I looked out the window and you could see the Capitol house. So that's the beautiful place. And then you see the real. This is where the people live. And everything downtown in Old Havana is made to look nice for the tourists. And they even think it's great that the cars from America are all from the 1940s and 50s. Because they've all been restored really nicely, probably 10 times. But it is not an honor. We had dinner at a nice restaurant twice, and the nice restaurant was in a doctor's home, former doctor's home from 1959 that the government took over, and now it's a restaurant. But the average wage, we talked to people on the worship team, an engineer with a degree makes $25 per month. The doctor on the worship team, the lady doctor, she's got a lot of degrees, and she makes $30 per month because ideologies love to tell you they want equality. They don't tell you that it's equality down here. And if you don't have family members in Miami or in Florida sending money back to Cuba, the cost of living is in the hundreds a month. But everybody makes $25 to $30 a month. Month. Let's keep going. Now, this is when we left the Sunday morning service. We drove 3 hours to another place because we were dedicating a new building and a new church that Pastor Zibby's church from Poland helped invest in. And so this is our rest stop. Now, I've got to qualify this. I told them I can't put this on social media yet. Pastor, so Ryan Wiebe was looking for a picture to post of me in Cuba. I don't take pictures of myself. I am not of the generation that can do selfies, okay? When I hold a thing out, I always look at the wrong place. So anyway, so somebody took a picture of me at the rest stop. That's my cooling towel, by the way. And listen to this. I had my first ever pina colada at the rest stop. Now, don't freak out. It was a virgin pina colada, okay? But my wife's been getting me on fruit smoothies lately, and in the last few months, I now regularly consume blueberries, peaches, and pineapple. I'd never had them in my life until the last few months. My mother actually almost fainted and wants to give my wife an award. But anyway, so out of that, I thought, well, I don't know what's in a pina colada. I said, I don't want any alcohol. And they said, okay, no, nobody's having that. No alcohol allowed on the missions trip anyway. So we go this pina colada thing. And I just tell you, I figured out, first of all, I do like pina coladas, getting caught in the rain. Not into yoga. And I have half a brain. But anyway, if you don't know what that means, ask somebody that's older. Okay? Anyway, first time I ever had a pina colada, I just had to show you. So that's the only picture of me in Cuba, is me with a pina colada. So I can see me posting that there and say, oh, pastor was wasted on Cuba trip. You know, no. Only drunk I got was in the Holy Spirit. That was the only thing I got. So anyway, we're at this rest stop. So then we go, keep going. Hang on. So now, put me back on the wall with pina colada, please. Okay, now. So we get to the next hotel, and it was a dump. It was substandard. And I called my wife. I could get on Wi-Fi and just had enough time to call her before we run out to another service, change clothes. That I stayed in that drenched outfit all day long, which wasn't good. Needed your prayers. I was going like, Lord, get the prayer warriors to pray. So I was lower than low. I was hot. I was hungry. I was cranky. So I called my wife. I said, pray for me. I just now heard. I got on Wi-Fi and got a thing from Pastor TK saying that the power had gone out. So I'm just seeing that about, you know, 5, 6 o'clock at night. I said to my wife, I need prayer. So she said, we'll be praying for you. I said, I got to go to another service. I'll call you later. I get to the service, and go ahead. Now you can go forward. I walk in, and it's the first air-conditioned church that I've ever seen in a third world country. Mini splits. And I walked in, and some of our team was like, oh, no, it's cold now. I'm like, ah, the angels were... I said, this is Florida, so good. This is, I can live in this. Anyway, go ahead, the next one. This is their service. It was great. It was awesome. The building was cool. Go ahead. This is the pastor. I thought it was pretty radical. You're not supposed to wear, I mean, there were flags in the other church where they pray for the nations, but they can't post an American flag. It's illegal. He's wearing an American flag t-shirt that says pastor on it. I'm thinking like, well, oh, I need to get me one of them, you know? Anyway, young, fiery pastor, 28 or 29 years old, reminded me of me when we started the church 33 years ago. Anyway, keep going. This is outside of our hotel, so we'll stop there for 1 second. I know I got to hurry, guys. But anyway, that night, as our team went to minister to other people, I turn around, and the speaker was praying for me. Our leader, Leif Hetland, was praying for me. And next thing you know, there are three main speakers, and they each prayed for me and started to prophesy over me, not knowing me. And it was so rich and powerful. I'll tell you that more another time, maybe in a couple weeks. But I mean, like stuff that only God would know. We're in this season, and all of a sudden, these words coming forth, and it was really refreshing. So as hard as the day was, I felt like I just want to stay in that hotel and cool down and get some food. But when you were praying, and I told my wife to please pray, God showed up, and that turned out to be my most powerful day, and probably the reason I went down there, one of the biggest reasons I went down there and received a lot of ministry and just powerful stuff. So thank God for that. I'll tell you more later. Pardon me. This is leaving on the bus the next day. These are the taxis waiting, and they're all really cool 1950s vehicles from America. Keep going. Okay, so now this begins on the way back then Tuesday morning from this Veradera. We are now going to five each bus. There's three buses of us, 40 people. Three buses. Our bus was, we were each going to five lighthouses of love to bring groceries, to bring food and supplies. So this is in the neighborhood of the first stop. Go ahead. This lady came out, and her face shined like the sun. She was happy and peaceful, and she started to cry, and she said, I thought you weren't coming because I heard it was going to rain today. And she started crying. She said, I'm so glad you're here. She said, you know, they've messed up my Cuba. They say mi Cuba. It's a mindset. They love their nation so much. She said, they've destroyed mi Cuba. And she said, now a lot of days I don't eat anything. She's got to be 80 years old. Has no food most days. She said, this bag of groceries will last me 2 weeks. And she smiled. She invited us into her house, and it was almost unlivable. Keep going. This is down an alleyway to the next house. Go ahead. This lady invited us into her. She's, every one of them said, you have to come into my house. This is her whole house. Behind her is the kitchen. Next to her is the bed. It's the bedroom. Under the stairs, there's a Mickey Mouse picture. Her grandson sleeps there. And it can't be, I'm not sure. This part of the platform, the entire house is this size of this part of the platform. And that's one of the bigger homes we went into. Keep going. This is a camp for people who've been displaced by a hurricane last year. Government put them in, this is like some of the worst conditions I've ever seen in my life. These people have been thrust into this place, placed there by the government. They don't know when they're gonna get out. The guy that was there from the church that we're ministering to is in a wheelchair and has lost his left leg. We came up to him. I wish you could see his face inside there. We said, we're here to pray for you. He said, before you do that, I want to know how all of you are. And the glory of God is on this guy. We said, no, we're good. Trust us, we're seeing this. We're good, we're here to pray for you. What can we pray for? What's your biggest need? He said, the people around me aren't saved yet. They need Jesus. He said, pray for them. I don't need anything. You brought me these groceries? I'm great. And I'm sitting there thinking how spoiled we are sometimes. Go ahead. These are the children next to that place that he said, please be praying for those kids. They don't know Jesus. They need Jesus. Go ahead. This is another house we prayed for, the one on the right. They weren't home, so we just prayed over the place, and we couldn't leave the groceries. They're going to give them to another time. Keep going. This is another home we went into, and it's an open place in the house where they put in a line for the toilet or something. And it would cost like 10 bucks to get a bag of cement, but there's no construction. There's no hardware stores. There's no grocery stores. If you want groceries down there and you don't have anything, you wait in one line for cheese all day long and maybe you get a block of cheese. The next day you have to wait in line for bread, and the next day you have to wait in line for milk or flour. It's no way for people to live. One of our ladies said, this is criminal to treat people like this. But that's what is trying to come to America. It's a spirit, and it's a demon, and has no power. keep going. This is her grandson of the lady in this house, and he is just, he's wearing really nice tennis shoes, and he is smiling, and they live in squalor, but he is happy and enjoying life. Keep going. This is the lady as he, we were presenting some groceries to her. Very sweet lady. All of the believers, listen, the unbelievers outside walk around hopeless. The believers are so filled with hope. It's amazing. Keep going. I gotta finish. Oh, that's all the pictures. Anyway, I thought I had a picture of this junction box above that lady's house, like 65-year-old electrical wiring into the house. I almost didn't want to go in the house, but I thought, well, she lives there. I'm going to go in by faith. Man, what we could do to help people like this. Trauma is the entry point for fear and the spirit of fear. But the Father's love, agape, has the power to cast out fear. Fear isn't just being afraid of something. It's intimidation or shrinking back from the bold faith God's placed inside of you. So I just want to tell you today, revival is brewing beneath the surface of the beautiful Cuban people. I don't have time to tell you. There are three things that have happened in the last 30 years, 35 years, I'd say, that have gradually opened the door for revival. And it is happening, and I'll be happy to tell you those in a couple weeks. I just don't have time to do it right now. Each of these powerful situations opened a small door to the people of Cuba to come back to God. And it's happening all over. People are getting saved left and right. People are being fed. The power of God is moving because the kingdom of God will always prevail. Amen? The kingdom of God will always prevail. The church of Jesus will arise and is rising again right now. Out of the ashes, God is making something beautiful. Let's give God a great hand, please. Come on, let's praise Him. Thank you, Lord. Would you bow your head and close your eyes for a moment? This is kind of why we came today. What traumatic trigger point have you been through that's not healed yet? What is it that you've been through? Have you been through a broken relationship? A broken report from the doctor about your own body? Broken finances? What area is broken right now where you need healing? Because the open door to try to put fear and intimidation on the lives of God's people is through traumatic events. But I'm here to tell you that the Word says the perfect love of God, the agape of the Father, casts out the spirit of fear. Today I want you to know, regardless of what your relationship with the Lord has been, right now you have an opportunity to get your life right with God and to be accepting of His love, the object of His affection. And all you have to do is receive it. It's a gift. If you don't know Jesus, you can simply just ask Him right now, Jesus, come into my heart. That's the beginning. That's the getting on place. But it's not the end, because we need waves of His glory, waves of the Father's love to cascade down upon us as we go through this life, because there are so many opportunities we have to be hurt or offended or broken, to be traumatized. But right now, right where you sit, the Lord can touch you. That's why we have to engage with Him in our worship and in the message of His Word. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, pray for me. I realize I've gone through something and I'm not myself. That's the word I get in my spirit right now. I'm not myself right now. I'm not myself right now. And I need a touch from heaven. I'm just going to ask you right now to stand up real quick. If that's you, just stand up. Be honest about it. You need a touch from God right where you are. You need a touch from God. And just lift up your hands. Just open your arms to receive. Now, you don't have to lift your hands high. Just lift them open. Just open. Just be open. Open yourself up. Yes. Oh, I want it. Fill me up, God. Fill these vessels right now. Let this be your prayer right where you sit or right where you stand right now. In the name of Jesus. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Lord, we release that Father's heart, that love of God right now. You know what? Leticia, come up here. Pastor Gail, come up here. Leticia, just come real quick. I know you've been hurt. Everybody else, keep standing if you're standing. Just put your arms around her right there. Stretch your hands toward Leticia. She's been through a trauma in the last week and a half. Overflow. Breathe the heart of the Father on this precious young lady. Right now, if you're a part of Now Church, you've been a part of us for, you know, you're part of the family, would you stand up right now and go and just grab a hold of people that have been standing? Just go hug them. Just go put your arm around them. Just go touch them. Just go to put your hand on their shoulder. Right now, Father, we ask you to fill this place up with your love right now. Let this body experience love, your heavenly love right now, your holy love right now. Let your presence and power move in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for cascading your love right now into everyone standing. Move strong in this place. Heavenly Father, let your love cast out all trauma, all fear goes in Jesus' name. All doubt goes in Jesus' name. We break every evil assignment with your love. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Tracy, pray for her right here. Right there, yeah, right there. Thank you, Lord. You are loved. You are loved. Watch out. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved with an just immeasurable love. Praise God. All right, everybody stand up for a moment. Just everybody stand up. Let's just worship God for a moment right where we are. Let's just thank him. Say this with me. Just say, Father, thank you for your love demonstrated through Jesus Christ, the ultimate price paid for me. I receive your love right now. No matter what I feel like, no matter what I feel I deserve, your word says, I am loved and I'm accepted and you'll never reject me. Heal me now and touch my life in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, give him praise right now. Oh, Lord, we bless you. Everybody take your seat again real quick. We're going to receive our tithes and offerings real, real fast. I've already gone over, but listen, we've gone an hour and a half in air conditioning in October. Okay? If you need an envelope, I need an I gave card. Shakima, please. Thank you. Thank you so much. If you need an envelope or an I gave card, please do. We're going to worship God. Here's one thing. Somebody said this on the trip, and I wrote it down. There's no such thing. Listen, this is really important. There's no such thing as a happy, ungrateful person. Second truth. Neither is there such a thing as an unhappy, grateful person. What I saw in Cuba was happy, grateful people that have nothing. That we would say, what do you have to be thankful for? How about oxygen? How about life? How about hope? How about a peace that passes understanding and a joy unspeakable? Amen. Grateful people are generous people. You know, they give offerings down there. They pay tithes and they give offerings on their $25 a month. Imagine having to be the pastor down there receiving an offering from people that you think have, they have nothing, but they have something. They have, if you have God with you, you have everything you need. And that's what the man in the wheelchair told us. He said, I got everything I need because I got Jesus. Pray for my friends. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Father, we thank you for blessing us. Thank you for every good gift. Thank you, Lord, that your love is the foundation, and we trust in you, and we believe your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Everybody, so thank you so much for your giving. We're going to have our boxes offering in just a moment and talk about that, so be ready for that in a moment. That's the song they were singing in Spanish in Cuba for 45 minutes. Fill me up till I overflow. I want to run over. When I got back, I found out that song is Tasha Cobbs. It's not even a Spanish song. It's from right here in America, one of our gospel singers. One time a month we do these three boxes offering. Just to let you know, there are other pockets of need in our church that help us to impact places like Cuba. We have our World Missions box right here. Now Missions goes and sends all over the world. We're able to help several different projects down in Cuba. The one is just helping with that tarp to keep people from getting rained on when they're at church. How basic, and yet we were able to be a blessing there. Heart Smile Foundation is the humanitarian arm of Now Church that reaches out into our community, because some people don't care about the nations, even though God does. And they say, what about our city? Well, that's what Heart Smile does, both here and also around the world from time to time. And finally, these are three, by the way, these are three non-budgeted items in the church budget. These are only supported, sponsored by whatever God blesses you and puts on your heart to do. And all we do is mention it once a month. This is our building fund. Now, we're super close. I told you we were a little over budget on the building, but we went ahead and God is moving and things are happening. But here's what happened. We still didn't get our CO. We passed four inspections last week and still were denied our CO by the fire marshal. Do we have that picture real quick of the induction stove? Do we have that? I guess we don't have that. Anyway, there it is. So this is in our new kitchen here. And these are induction burners. We were advised by professional people in the restaurant business. These are the kind, very safe. You can't burn yourself on them. They're heated by magnets. It's an induction. And so we were told in the design and the approval of the design, we wouldn't need specific hooded outlets and range stuff. Well, the fire marshal has denied that now and said, well, I don't know why the electromechanical hardware guy approved it and why this got approved. And why initially it was approved, and now the fire marshal said that because He wants it to be this way. We have to put in two ugly things on top of this that are going to vent everything to outside at the cost of about $8,000. We're this close. So I'm just telling you right now, if anybody can help us, I'm tired. One of the things that happened is these pastors came to me and said, "You're tired," and started to minister to me the refreshing of the power of God and prophetic words on what God is about to do in our church. A new day, a new hope. One guy said, "New wine and vintage wine." The guy prayed over me and said, "Papa is popping the cork on new wine and vintage wine that's been inside of you for many years." And I was down on the floor three times with these prayers last week. They ministered to me probably about seven times. At one point, all three of the speakers had prayed for me, and all of a sudden I see the two main speakers coming at me one more time, and the man of God said, "We both felt we need to come and honor you and bless you and pray for you for what you're doing there." And one guy, the Filipino pastor, leaned over to me and he said, "I hear God say, well done. Well done. I'm proud of you for finishing this task. And I'm grateful. If you can help us in these, please help us. I want to pray for you. Father, would you pour out your spirit on this place? We are open. We want the new wine and we want the vintage wine. We want you to move in healing and in deliverance and in power and in strength and in wholeness and in prophecy and in all the gifts and the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, and move in us. Lord, help us to pass this and to finish this building and to get in and help get those kids in their classrooms. In Jesus' name. Amen." Come, whenever you want.
Just have a few announcements before you go. We have church-wide prayer happening this Wednesday. It's a great time to gather together and really just push things forward in the Spirit, and that's going to be taking place at 7 o'clock right here in this room on Wednesday. Please remember to pray for our DC team. We're going to be continuing to pray for them on Wednesday as we gather, but remember them through this week, if you will, and just be praying for them. That we've always said that as we send a team, whether it be mission, whether it be a DC trip, prayer trip, we all go. There's a few people that go, but we all go in spirit, right? So let's just invest that in everybody that is going. And also, for some of you that are newer, we have several people that are newer to Now Church. We have liftoff coming up in just a few weeks. In fact, it's Sunday the 15th. Please mark that. If you have that right there, you can use this QR code to sign up. I will be contacting you, and we're going to be doing this and probably doing this the first time in the Legacy Building. Shh, it's going to be awesome. And so... And then the ushers, we have these prayer sheets that I gave you already before, or that I showed you already before, right back there in the back. Ushers, showing them off. Before you go, make sure you pick up one of those for your family. Post it somewhere where you're going to see it every day. And please be just in agreement and prayer and praying for us. We love that prayer. Thank you so much. Go ahead, stand up. We love you. Have a great week. Hopefully see you Wednesday.
Thanks for joining us at Now Church. For the latest updates, visit us at nowchurch.com, including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you.